Hello, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the show. This is T-Bone logging in with an episode of On the Battlefield. So today, it's tank review time again with the Leichttraktor, the German Tier 1 light tank. So without further ado, let's get started. So here we are in the garage with the Leichttraktor, commonly referred to as the Leichttraktor. So why is that? Well, let's find out. As is traditional with all tank reviews, let's look at the stats. The Leichttraktor has the second highest health pool of 130 hit points. If this tank was a prize fighter, it would be a middleweight, weighing in at 8.34 tons in my configuration. The Maybach HL38TR gives the tank 110 horsepower. The tank has an average power to weight ratio in its tier of 12 horsepower per ton, with the second highest top speed of 36 km per hour. Even with good terrain resistance in its tier, it can reach that speed, but it can take a while to get there on soft and medium terrain. It has the best hull traverse in its tier of 40 degrees per second on the upgraded tracks, and the highest turret traverse of 39 degrees. This means this tank is incredibly maneuverable. It has the third highest camo rating for its tier, making it stealthier than half of its tier 1 opponents. The Leichttraktor has the best view range in its tier of 310 meters. With the FUG 2 radio, the signal range will increase from 90 meters to 265 meters, which is average in its tier. It does have excellent gun depression at 10 degrees and a great elevation of 30 degrees. As for the armor, it is Mr. Average with 14mm on the front of the hull and 12mm on the side and rear. The turret has the same frontal armor as the hull with 13mm at the side and rear. Using the collision model on Tank Inspector actually shows that this tank isn't quite as described on paper. While the front of the hull is 14mm, there is a weak spot on the front which is only 5mm thick. This makes the medium 1's armor seem generous. The top of the hull is 8mm with another weak spot over the hatch, which again is 5mm. The side is indeed 12mm with the tracks counting as 5mm of spaced armor. As for the rear armor, most of it is 12mm with the door to the right being 8mm thick. The turret is as described though, with minor weak spots to the left of the gun mantlet and through the viewports. So what about the guns? Well, there are three choices available on the Leichttraktor. The 2cm KWK and the 2cm Breeder are both machine guns with appalling accuracy of 0.57 and 0.53 respectively. These really are spray and pray weapons that realistically are only effective at close range. In my opinion, the best gun on this tank is actually the stock gun, the 3.7cm KWK 36L46.5. This gun has an average penetration and damage of 40mm and 36 hit points with standard ammunition. It will fire at 27 rounds per minute with a reload time of 2.2 seconds, giving this gun a potential 979 damage per minute. It has an accuracy of 0.46 with a superb aiming time of 1.7 seconds. This means that the gun is aimed before even the next shell has been reloaded. With a rapid rate of fire, it is easy to take out an opponent as long as you use the right tactics. If you do decide to keep this tank, then the options will be to increase the camo rating of the tank by using a camonet, camouflage, and add view range enhancements. Due to the excellent base range this tank has, I would highly recommend using binoculars and scouting for your team. In my opinion, the third slot would be for vents to improve all crew skills and how the tank performs. As for crew skills, if you do have 100% crew, I'd consider going for camouflage to reduce the camo rating even further. With all that discussed and out of the way, let's get on the battlefield and see how this thing drives in my hands. So here we go on Malinovka. It's a 9v9 game and it's exclusively Tier 1. Probably down to the time of day I was actually playing this game, to be fair. Analyzing the team list, I can see there's a very good medium 1 player on the enemy team, so I'll have to watch out for him. In the meantime, I'm not sure why the NC31 is just firing his gun, and the T1 as well. Guys, wait until you see an enemy. Trust me, it's better. So I trundle over. I'm heading to around E7 to actually carry out some spots for my team. And ahead of me is a little T1, who according to his stats is a tomato player. But we'll definitely see more of him later. Well, not bad movement speed. I'm getting about 30-35 out of this tank at the moment. Now, I did acknowledge the T1 and say that I'd help him, but I am going to spot in these bushes, so I'm not sure how much help will be. Oh! T1 goes in the middle of the field and dies immediately. I love that. Drive out into an open field and there's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 enemy tanks on the other side. Good plan. Excellent. So I'm just going to set up the camera net and binoculars and see what I can spot while the T1 goes to this corner around C9. So while there is a lull in the action, let me give you a little history about this tank. The Leichttraktor was produced in secret under the restrictions placed on Germany for military development by the Treaty of Versailles. Leichttraktor was its cover name, with two prototypes built by Rheinmetall and Krupp. The main differences between these being the suspension configuration. The tank was tested in the Soviet Union under the Treaty of Rapallo. Rheinmetall was awarded an order for 289 tanks, but this was cancelled, leaving only 4 prototypes ever built between 1930 and 1934. That's enough history, now back to the action. So we're getting on for nearly 3 minutes into the game, and we haven't spotted anything yet. And that's despite an excellent view range. I think it's over 390 meters. The Aratsu is making his way up quite nicely, but nothing. Where's the enemy? This is very, very strange. Oh, hang on. T1. Down the zero. And another one. How did they not get spotted? Really? That's incredible. Okay, come on. Let's see if we can get a shot on these guys. I'm waiting. Uh-huh, here we go. Nope, goes too high. Come on, pop up. Yes, come on. Nice. Come out, wherever you are. Come on, Aratsu, go and spot them. So, okay. Well, the Aratsu is not going to spot them. I'll start moving then. Oh, hang on. Here we go. Aim. Yes. And again. Oh, lovely. Nice toasted T1. Right then, who's next? Ooh, target spotted on the enemy base around F3. Yeah, that'll do. Okay, I'll take a nice supporting fire position then. Okay, who's first? Aha, medium 1. That'll do. Probably hit, not sure. Yep, shot again. And again. There we go. A marshmallowed medium 1. And another one in as quick as a wink. It just gives you the idea of the rate of fire of this gun and how quickly you can pick apart an opponent. But I've fired several shots at this T1. And admittedly, it's 330 meters, but can I hit him? Oh, can now, but it took several shots to do it. Okay. So, got a T1 that's managed to sneak past and head to our base. Right, okay, let's move to intercept. Right then, team, who's with me? Oh, T1's coming as well, fantastic. Anything from here? Not yet. Oh, there's another one, but just out of the render range, so turn back. Any shots on this T1? No, in hard cover, that's no good. All right, let's see where we can move into a better firing position. Any better? No. Not from that guy. But he gets taken out anyway by our T1. Nice job. Oh, just giving my position away by being a lumberjack. Never mind. And, oh, another T1 spotted. Any shots? Yes. Here we go. Good positive hit. And again. I missed that time. Come on. Got him. Marshmallows, anyone? Okay. Well, not much spotted in their base, so I'm going to start trundling up the flank. We've got a medium one, an MS one and a T1 left, and it's the really good medium one as well. He's got a kill on his belt, but I've got four kills at this point. So, I'm feeling quite positive. But, I suppose the question is, can I get a top gun? Well, let's see. So after a lot of driving, I spot the medium one, but I think the medium one spotted me. Oh, just missed. Come on. Pick him apart. Fires at me. One more shot. Ah, and the medium one takes me out. Now, on reflection, probably what I should have done once I'd taken my shots and had that lucky miss was pull back, broke contact, and then re-engaged from a different position. But never mind. So who does that leave on our team? Well, we've got an R-O-T-2, a T1, and a medium one. Now, remember the T1 I was talking about earlier? Well, this is him. Now, as you can see from the stats above his tank, that is his current WN8 rating. So, a little bit cruelly, but red WN8 players are known as tomatoes. In the meantime, the R-Otsu comes out flank on to a T1 that's popping over the ridge. Now, the R-Otsu's pre-aimed. So, who's going to win this one? Well, I don't know. But let's see. Oh, nice shot from the R-Otsu. But I think potentially a little bit lucky. And then an MS-1 approaches. R-Otsu misses. MS-1 doesn't. And I'm afraid for that R-Otsu. It's goodnight, Vienna. So back to our T1 friend. Yeah, as I was saying, tomato players are known by because of the red colour on their WN8 rating, but I never underestimate the power of tomato just as he spots a medium one with three times his stats. But the thing is that even players with these sort of stats can pull out a unique in game. It just doesn't happen all that often. But I do wonder what's going through this T1's mind right now. I can just imagine the tension as he sits there and wonders what he's going to do. Okay, good start. Breaks the fence, which I don't think he'd see. Comes up from concealment. Now, just nudges the cap circle. That was a mistake by the T1, so now the medium one knows exactly his position. He's come up towards the medium where the medium one was, and no sign. Wow, he's managed to get around, so he's actually used cover and concealment to his benefit. But this is a real duel at high noon. I'm tense just watching it, and I've watched this replay a few times now. So with the T1 capping and pre-aiming. Oh my goodness, that was close. Oh. Come on, T1, use your maneuverability. You're not. You're going to take pot shots with the 37mm. Okay. Oh my goodness. Wow. That was incredible. So the medium one rolls really high. Almost taking the T1 out in one shot. But somehow the T1 connects the shot and the medium one's taken out. Wow. What an ending. And that has to be one of the luckiest T1 drivers I've ever seen. So, after a tense finish, a victory on Malinovka for our team. In my case, the result gave me a second class mastery badge, fighter, which is awarded for destroying 4-5 enemy vehicles, and fire for effect for causing more damage to the enemy vehicles than the hit points of my vehicle. I spotted one tank, critically damaging 3 and destroying 4. 9,519 credits earned on a premium account with 567 experience, which is undoubled. That result may not look all that impressive, but according to Yasin Krasen, that was a Unicum game securing a WN8 of 2,762. I managed to come top on damage and experience with 422 damage done and 378 base experience. The rest of the team didn't do too badly at all, with two-thirds of the team contributing to the fight. From the detail report, I fired 20 shots, with 14 hits and penetrations to make 422 damage, three-quarters of which was from a distance of over 300 meters. An honourable mention should go to Secret Gun in the medium one on the opposing team for a game well played. 21 shots fired, 7 hits, 6 penetrations, 389 damage, and 3 kills. However, you came across Birdie in the T1 Cunningham, who was the luckiest tanker on the battlefield. If the first shot had connected in the cap circle, or perhaps a HE round had been used and rolled a little high, then the result would have been very different. Also, if Birdie had used the T1 speed and maneuverability along with the 20mm Hispano-Suiza gun to outmaneuver the medium one, I believe that that would have tipped the balance firmly in his favour. Still, a victory is a victory nonetheless, certainly a very satisfying way to end this particular battle. Now on to our second replay. This is Mr. Paccio Chimel in his Leichttraktor in a Tier 1 exclusive game on Provence. Another map that Tier 1 players will never see since patch 9.10 was introduced. Mr. Paccio has only played 42 battles with a win rate of 69% and a whopping WN8 of 3,364. As per usual, I'll let you be the judge whether he is a talented newbie or an account reroll. So, as we start this replay, most of the team are new players, there's a couple that are a little bit more experienced, but as we start the game, he goes on a mountain climbing exercise. So, I think it's time to cue the music. Now, I know the music isn't Thunderbirds, but it should be at this point. It really should. What do you mean you've not heard of Thunderbirds? Really? Honestly, what do they teach you kids these days? Oh, good grief. Almost there. So, as Virgil and Scott manage to pilot this tank into position, let's see what we can do. T1 on the other side of the ridge. Nope. Must be over 400 meters, surely. Okay, that one connects. And that one. Oh, but he just misses out on taking the kill. All right, next one. Renault FT. Now, how many people are tilting their heads to the left at the moment while they're watching this? Or tilting their device? Oh, he's managed to get some effective firing, which is good, but he hasn't killed anything just yet. Oh, here we go. Medium one. Ooh, just short. Good hit. 524 meters. Keep shelling that position, but so far, no joy. Right, so takes out the ammo rack in the cap circle. Now then, starts shelling common camping positions to see if he can get any hits, but all of a sudden, someone is in the cap circle. Aha, T1. Great hit on the move. Really unfortunate that didn't pen. Now, who's going to blink first? Well, that would be the T1, who's now toasted. So, Mr. Papiccio is using the cover of these rocks really well at this point. And then jumps and power slides down the hill. Okay, Renault FT spotted. Being really cautious, and I don't blame the FT actually for being this cautious, but all of a sudden drives out. Flank on. Good hit. Land short, okay. Come on, son. You can do this. All right. A few minutes later. Good shot. But that one bounces off. Leaves him on 7 health. And that doesn't pen. Oh, so frustrating. Only for a light tractor to start peppering him with machine gun fire. So he gets into hard cover. As a T1 starts moving up the hill. Alright. T1 may have disappeared, but my betting will be he's going to come up after him. Yep, indeed he does. But he's trying to work out exactly what he's going to do. He's got the 20mm gun, by the looks of it. He's trying to maneuver the tank to get a shot, but unfortunately, Mr. Papcio takes him out for kill number two. Now, we know someone's crossed the cap circle, so let's take a look, see if we can spot them. I wonder where they are. There's a light tractor. Maybe that's the one that was shooting at us before. No, snapshots that and misses. It's probably the FT that we saw earlier. Yep, certainly is. So, once again, he's going mountain climbing. Somebody decides to whiff a shot in his direction, but unfortunately that misses as well. Alright, so moving a little bit further on, there's a light tractor now on the hill taking shots at him. Pulls back really quickly into cover. Now, has he got the shot? Oh, just misses. But takes the light tractor out, so that's good night for Hans. Okay, so now he starts moving up the 9-0 line. So we're going to skip ahead a little bit until eventually is on the H line. Good shot. Come on, T1. There's an enemy tank firing at you. Can you move? No? Yes? Oh, no. Okay, fair enough. So another toasted T1. So we've gone from 1 versus 5 to 1 versus 3. So who's left? Well, we've got the FT. He's climbing up the hill. Can he take him out? Good blind shot. So we've got an R-Otsu and a medium one left. All right, then. Let's see where these guys are at. Well, we've got a medium one last spotted at F3. So I wonder whether the medium one is still there. Now, this is where this tank really, really struggles and can do with a little more horsepower as it comes uphill. Oh, hello. Base cap. So he's got a minute 30 to get this tank over to where he needs to be. I hope he does it. All right, 40 seconds to go, and he spots a medium one and state opens fire. The tank's to your left. Up there, up the hill, that way. Oh, dear me. So I think it's story time, guys, so sit back and relax and enjoy.
This is the story of Barry the Lemming. Barry was a cousin of Larry's and had seen his exploits in the T1 Cunningham. Barry was eager to have a go himself. So one day he sneaked into a medium one and took the gunner's position.
"Who's this?"
asked the commander abruptly.
"What's happened to Sergeant Reardon?"
Barry stalled for a moment and then replied,
"I'm sorry, sir, but he's called in sick with dysentery."
"I told him not to order that dodgy takeaway last night,"
barked the commander.
"Oh well, you'll do. Now please, pay attention."
"Yes, sir,"
exclaimed Barry. Initially, Barry did exactly what the commander told him to do. But unfortunately, like a number of lemmings, he does suffer from a short attention span. Unbeknown to the commander, Barry unplugged the headphones from the intercom and plugged it into his portable music player, bought by Larry as a birthday present. While Barry was rocking out to his favourite tunes, a Leichttraktor appeared on the hill.
"Enemy tank at 270, range 200 metres, elevation 25 degrees. Driver, move into position. Gunner, stand ready to fire."
Unfortunately, the driver had spotted that Barry was having such a good time that he wanted to listen to and was rocking out to the same music. The commander gave the order again. No response. The Leichttraktor had opened fire and shells were raining down into the tank.
"What's that banging noise?"
thought Barry.
"Maybe it's in the drum solo."
The commander was furious at this point. He tapped Barry on the shoulder.
"Damn it, man! I told you, enemy tank to your left twice and we're under fire! What the hell are you doing?"
"Oh no!"
exclaimed Barry and started to turn the gun towards the Leichttraktor, but it was too late. As the last shell hit, the tank burst into flames. The commander was incandescent with rage as he was stretchered towards the ambulance. He muttered to himself that he would never allow a lemming to be part of his crew. Meanwhile, Barry was taken to Lemming Hospital and treated for burnt fur and hurt pride. While he was lying in his bed, he thought about his experience, deciding that maybe listening to music wasn't the best thing while being in a tank. So as the music dies away, we can get back to the serious business of commentating on this game. So the R-Otsu is left and capping. Oh, that bounced. Come on, can you do it? Oh my goodness. Yes, good shot. One left. Yes. Takes him out and manages to get 7 kills and secure the game for the team. Well, that was a fantastic result for Mr. Papcho there, with a clutch of medals to boot. Ace Tanker, Fire for Effect, Duelist, Bruiser, a Defender's Medal for reducing the cap points by over 70 or more, Top Gun for destroying at least 6 tanks,
And of course, the one that everyone wants, Kolobanov's medal for facing at least 5 enemy tanks alone. This may not be the game with the highest kills or damage on World of Tanks replays for patch 9.9, but it is certainly one of the more entertaining to watch. He spotted 3 enemy tanks, critically damaging 5 and destroying 7. He racked up 778 damage, 3 times that of the top player on the enemy team and more than the top 6 allied players on his team combined. He fired a total of 56 shots with 30 hits and 24 penetrations to cause 778 damage, 182 of which was from over 300 meters. He managed to bounce 6 shots of the 9 received in the match and reduced the capture points by 100 in total. He made 8,715 credits on a standard account. If it was a premium account, he would have banked 14,575 after resupply costs. Even with a Lemming on the enemy team in the medium one, I still tip my hat off to Mr. Papcio for a game well played. So, the Leichttraktor definitely lives up to its reputation as being the Lolltraktor. It's a fun little tank, mainly due to its maneuverability and speed that only a T1 Cunningham could outrun. Add to that a fantastic view range, and it is easy to turn this tank into a scout for your team. The excellent gun depression allows you to work a ridgeline successfully with armour that may bounce a shot or two if you're lucky. With a rear-mounted turret, side-scraping is potentially an option on city maps. Just be careful how you drive round a corner though. The excellent aim time allows you to pop out and take shots ducking into cover. It is no wonder why this little German tank has a special place in a lot of tankers' garages. That brings this episode to a close. Join us again on the battlefield. Until next time, take care and enjoy your gaming. This is T-Bone logging off.